Welcome back to the GCN Tech Clinic, where I help solve your bike-related problems and all sorts of conundrums that you send in. How do you send them in then? Well, easiest way, leave it down there as a comment in the comments section down below, and I'll do my very best to answer it in a forthcoming episode. But as ever, let's crack on, shall we, with the first question this week, and it comes in from Phil Adams. Phil says, John, I'm building a bike for Everesting, and I want really low gears. I can get some mountain bike cranks or a derailleur extender to allow up to 40 teeth on the back. Would one be better than the other? Any disadvantages? Right then, Phil, fancy a cheeky bit of Everesting, do you? Now, for those of you who don't know what Everesting is out there, it's when you find yourself a hill and you repeatedly ride up and down it all day long until you climb the equivalent height of Mount Everest, which is, I think, 8,848 meters. Now, Ollie did it recently. He did it pretty well as well, I do believe. Anyway, enough about Ollie, enough about Everesting. What about that tech problem? Right, those mountain bike cranks, yeah, they'll be absolutely fine, I imagine, providing, of course, you can get your front neck low enough to accommodate the inside chainring on there. But personally, I would not go for that because your Q factor is going to be pushed out compared to what you're used to, I imagine. And if you are riding all day, that's not what you want to happen, is it? So I'd go for the derailleur hanger extender, so you can use that big old 40-tooth cassette at the rear. Just make sure, though, that your chain is long enough to be able to accommodate it, and also that it doesn't make foul or anything like that if you do go onto the big ring. I don't imagine you will be going on the big ring, though, much of that day. But anyway, good luck with that Everesting, and I reckon derailleur hanger extender. I use one on a one-by-hack. A couple of months ago on a video I did here on GCN Tech, and I found it to be absolutely brilliant. And now we've got a question from Jesper, who, Jesper has a problem. They're riding Dura 7800 on the TT bike, and they're finding jockey wheels is a pain. Is there any chance that an Altegra 6700 derailleur will fit with the current levers? Nice to hear from you, Jesper. Do you know what? That 7800 Dura Ace groupset was stunning. One of my favourites, actually, of the Dura Ace offerings. Now, yeah, those parts are all interchangeable with one another. There was a Shimano Dura Ace group set, I think it was the original 8-speed STI one, that wasn't compatible across the other offerings, so 105 and Altegra, but these days they are all interchangeable. However, as for putting that 6700 derailleur on, yeah, you could well do that, but I would actually hunt around. You aren't gonna hunt very high, you're not gonna hunt very low. You are gonna find some replacement 11-tooth jockey wheels to go inside of that rear mech, and you'll be able to carry on using that 7800 one. So have a look around, you'll be easily be able to find them and put those in there. Just remember though, they are upper and lower specific for a reason. So just bear that in mind when you're fitting them in. And good luck, keep riding that TT bike. I'm jealous of that 7800. Next up is a question from Adrian Hearn. Now, it's quite a lengthy question, as you can see on screen right now, but the long and short of it, or I've got to the crux of it really, Adrian's problem is that their freehub is spinning the cranks when you freewheel. So I imagine it's more noticeable actually when you're in a work stand. So imagine the bike is up in a work stand, you spin the cranks away, walk away from the bike, and the cranks are still going around, albeit quite slowly in comparison to the rear wheel. What could it be then on those Mavic wheels? Well, actually, it's a really, really well-sealed freehub design, in my opinion, from Mavic. And it looks kind of like this. So on the freehub, in between where the freehub sits onto the actual hub shell, you have a rubber washer like this. And I'm pretty sure that's what your problem is. This rubber washer does an amazing job of keeping all the water and the grime out. However, the job it doesn't do so well is dealing with friction. So the rubber washers from time to time can go up against the actual hub shell, and in turn, as the hub shell's spinning, the free hub starts to spin with it too. Now, that can also cause a noise, which you also touched on in there, and I had a pair of Mavic wheels at one point, and they had one of these washers on there, and it made a really, really loud screeching noise when I was freewheeling. Only on occasion though, so it wasn't too bad. How did I solve it then? And also that kind of grippy or sticky free hub. Well, I got that rubber washer off and I actually cut along it. So I cut probably half of it away. Now, the downside of that obviously is that it's not gonna be as well sealed or protected against the elements, but the good side is basically it worked a little bit better, I guess. So it wasn't as screechy. In fact, it got rid of all the screeching noises. And also, it meant it was a smoother or less resistance drivetrain when freewheeling. So that is certainly an option for you. Next up, we've got Toby R, who says, "Hey John, I want to change my 33mm cyclocross tyres to road tyres. On the rim, it says 21622. Can I put 28mm road tyres on there, or should I stick with 32? Right then, Toby, that 21 out of those digits denotes the internal rim width. So in your case, 21mm. So you are gonna be absolutely fine to put a pair of 28s on there. Now, it's not always plain sailing, believe me, when you're trying to put tyres and rim combinations together, because sometimes you can lose a lot of skin on your thumbs and also strain them, that kind of thing. Recently, it happened to me, a friend of mine asked me around, could you fit this tyre on for me? I'm having a bit of a problem. Yeah, about 2 hours later, we got it on. Anyway, yeah, sprained a thumb actually doing that. Some combinations are just a nightmare, but you'll probably be okay on that because that's quite a wide internal rim width. You'll also be traveling quite a bit faster from now on because you're not gonna have the extra resistance of cyclocross tyres. So yeah, 28s on those rims, spot on. Go ahead, do it. Okay, now we've got Eat, Ride, Grow, who says, John, could you help me? I was wondering if it's possible to use a Shimano Alphine DI2 road shifter set with an Ultegra RX800 DI2 rear derailleur and a 1x11 transmission. I'm not sure if the Ultegra DI2 setup will work without a front derailleur, and I'd like to know before investing any money in it. Right then, I checked the compatibility sheets from Shimano, the most up-to-date ones, and it will work absolutely fine. As for using it without a front derailleur, again, that is absolutely fine. All that will happen is when you set it all up within the eTube app or the eTube software, it just won't detect a front derailleur, obviously, because you don't have one. But nothing to worry about there. It will work, it's all plain sailing. And well, you're gonna have yourself a nice little setup there. It's something I've looked to in the past because ultimately you've still got a great lever shape and it's quite a good cost-effective way to do it. Nice one. Next up is Trit Gerries, who asks, is there any problem with running all-purpose grease as a lubricant? Right, great question this. I'm gonna do my very, very best to answer it. I'm not a grease or an oil expert, but let's just get to the nitty gritty of it, if you like. So grease is actually oil plus a thickener, and you're looking for using it as a lubricant. Now, the only place really you're gonna use a lubricant on a bike is going to be on your chain, because a lubricant is more oil-based. So if you were to put an all-purpose grease on there, it's gonna be too thick, really, to get into the inner workings of the chain, and it is gonna be pretty messy. I have seen people use an all-purpose grease as a lubricant for a chain in the past, and those were a few pro mechanics just before the start of a torrential downpour at a bike race. The thinking and the reasoning behind that was actually to try and get the lubricant that they'd already applied to stay on the chain for longer, because all that rain was gonna wash it away. There was, in fact, another team there. They lubricated up the chain and then they covered it in Vaseline, of all things, because of course it's water repellent. I wouldn't recommend doing that on your own bits and pieces at home, because you're likely to destroy the chain pretty quick. So in short, no, I wouldn't use an all-purpose grease as a lubricant. Certainly not for your chain. Next up is Lucas, and Lucas recently replaced their 23mm wide tyres with 25s. Since doing this, basically gravel and dead leaves stick to the tyres and jams up in between the bike, so the frame and the fork and the tyres. It rubs against the tyres, and Lucas says it slows them down, and to actually get rid of them from jamming up, they have to stop, get off, and poke them away. Now this, Lucas, I can genuinely feel for you here. Some bikes out there, sadly, have been designed in such a way that 25mm tyres just simply don't work. They don't allow the clearances and they don't allow the tyre to actually pass through, which is really, really sad, because the state of most people's roads out there these days, the change from going to a 25mm tyre from 23 is pretty noticeable in terms of comfort. The bike I recently upgraded to a 1xHack, the clearances on that, again, are mega, mega close. I can't fit 25mm in there. I've got a friend of mine with a very, very high-end premium bike. I put some 25mm tyres in there and it was rubbing on the underside of the forks too. So Unfortunately, it sounds like 23 millimeters are the only way to go, I'm afraid. So it looks like you will be having to get those 23s. Sorry. Now, Simon H has got a disc brake question. Now, Simon asks, on the question of disc brake upgrades, how about running calipers at the back and upgrade to discs with a new fork and wheel at the front only? So similar to older cars who had discs at the front only, would be a lot cheaper than getting a new frame. Right, Simon, that's certainly a possibility. And in fact, riders have done that. The only thing to consider would be how the controls feel, so how your brake levers feel, particularly if you're using drop bar levers, because obviously those hoods are going to feel different. On a flat bar, less of an issue really, because you don't tend to ride on them as much, but your controls are obviously really key to both stopping you as well as controlling the bike too. So that would be my main concern there, but yeah, it can be done. Final question this week comes in from Fillet O' Fish. Now, Fillet O' Fish asks, odd problem, Ultegra DI2 related. The front derailleur seems to need the battery to be at no less than 75% to work reliably. Battery stroke firmware issue. Right then, first up, make sure that firmware is up to date. So plug it in to the eTube app or software and just actually upgrade everything where necessary if it's needed. Now, something else to consider is that the cables, so all of your DI2 cables are plugged in absolutely spot on. There's no water that's got in there, anything like that. And also they're not snagged anywhere. I do know someone who managed to somehow pierce an outer cable with a water bottle cage bolt that went through. And every now and then that cable would just bash against the bolt and essentially would short circuit it. And it would give them all sorts of problems basically with their shifting. So make sure that nothing like that's happened. I know it's a lot of work potentially to actually go inside of your frame and check all those cables, but well, it is going to be worth it. In rare or exceptional circumstances, yeah, it could well be the battery. If that is the case, then I suggest you pop along to your local Shimano dealer who will be able to help you out with that. But really, that's as far as we can go with these sorts of things, because they are, of course, electronic components. But I do hope, Fillet O' Fish, that that's been able to help answer or get you a little bit further along the problem. Now, I hope that I've been able to answer your question this week. If not, make sure you leave it for me down there in the comments section down below or on all forms of social media using the hashtag on screen right now. Now, remember as well to like and share this video. Give it a big old thumbs up. Share it with your friends, especially if they've got a bike-related problem. I love to tackle them. So if you've got a club mate who's out riding, their bike is giving them havoc, make sure they leave it for me down there. Don't forget to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. We have a whole heap of goodies for you to spend your pocket money on. And now, for another great video, how about clicking just over here?